Hello YouTube. Today I'm going to talk to you about using fridge and air conditioning compressors as cheap vacuum pumps. Now, with the cost of manufacturing of cheap vacuum pumps already low enough, for example, Harbor Freight, $100 for a quite acceptable vacuum pump, you might not be so motivated to try and build one yourself out of repurposed parts. However, for those that don't have access to Harbor Freight, such as Canadians, we have to be a little bit more resourceful. Now, it's been known for quite a long time that you can use fridge and air conditioning compressors as vacuum pumps. That's exactly what I've done with this setup. It's almost completely set up for general usage now, and I've managed to get quite an acceptable vacuum. Now, unfortunately, my vacuum gauge here is very crappy. It's only like $2, so it won't give me an accurate representation of the true vacuum strength. However, it will let me know that there is vacuum on the line and manifold that I've built. But first, more about fridge compressors and air conditioning compressors. Apologies for the poor artwork. This is the best I could do on short notice. Regardless, there are a couple different types of pumps that you will find in either air conditioning or refrigeration compressors, or just as vacuum pumps. The traditional vacuum pump, at least today, is based off of the rotary design. You have a spinning rotor with sliding vanes, spring-loaded, which keep contact with the chamber walls at all time. You have an input and an output with the rotor spinning in this direction. As the rotors spin, the vanes keep contact with the wall and keep this capacity static. Well, not static. As the vanes turn, rather, the capacity will decrease, but the amount of gas in moles won't change, so it will be compressed and pushed out the exhaust. You'll find these rotary pumps in, say, Edwards vacuum pumps, or even just refrigeration vacuum pumps that service technicians would use. Now, in air conditioning rotary pumps, you have a slightly different design. You have a fixed vane, which is spring-loaded, and a rotating elliptical rotor. Essentially, it does the same thing where one side has more volume and one side has less. As the rotor turns, the large volume turns into a small volume and gas gets compressed. All of these do the same type of thermodynamic work. It's just how they do it, how efficiently they do it, and the maximum achievable pressures. Piston pumps. You'll see these in the UK more often, as well as for small fridge compressors, whereas these are more popular for air conditioning units and the like, at least for windowsill size units. These piston pumps have a lower maximum achievable pressure, mainly because of these valves. They aren't as good a seal as properly machined vane. And in rotary pumps, they're even better because you have two stages, typically, which gives you a higher maximum pressure. Regardless, a single-stage piston pump still works as a compressor. In fact, most workshop air compressors are based off the piston design, not a rotary design, just simply because they can have a higher maximum volume. Regardless, that's another design that you'll find. More popular in the UK, not as popular in North America. And then the scroll pump, which you will find in large household air conditioning units as well as commercial air conditioning units. These are really efficient, they give the best maximum achievable pressure, but they're damn expensive because they're precision machined pieces of metal. And it's a little bit too complicated to explain it. It's outside the scope of this video, but they're two metal scroll-shaped machined pieces that interleave and oscillate back and forth, which does the same compression. You can look it up elsewhere on YouTube for some animations on how scroll compressors work. If you find one for cheap, by all means use this. Otherwise, an air conditioning rotary pump is just as good. And this is the type I'm talking about for this video. Now, at this point, you probably want to see the vacuum pump itself. What I've done is I've taken a new old stock Surplus R22, or Freon, air conditioning compressor. This is a rotary model for North America. Now, there's some differences between a small fridge compressor and an air conditioning compressor. Most notably the fact that air conditioning compressors include run and start windings, whereas most refrigeration compressors, at least for fridges, just have two terminals where you hook up the power and thermal protection. Now, you have three connections here. You have the black wire here, which is, in my case, the common and live wire, the white wire, which leads to the run winding, and the green wire, which leads to the start winding. The start winding has a lower resistance, it's a little bit beefier, and it pushes more current through. It gives that initial starting torque necessary to start the motor. Now, with fridge compressors, they'll just start when you apply power. However, if you try and start them under load, with some back pressure on the output or exhaust side, they won't start. But in the case of these rotary air conditioning compressors, with the help of the start winding, you can start them while there's either vacuum on the vacuum side or some back pressure on the exhaust side. But regardless, to actually start this, you'll need a what's known as a potential relay or a motor start relay to actually engage and disengage this start winding. You have to do this because the start winding draws so much power and it draws so much current, it's going to overheat and the motor isn't designed for that. So you have to turn on the start winding and then pull it out of circuit once the motor is running. What I've also found is that in the case of these air conditioning compressors, because they're not running as designed, it's a little bit hard to properly start them. You have to start them in two stages, which I'll show now. What I have is the vacuum hose here set up with a small manifold in the back, and this vacuum gauge, a very crappy vacuum gauge, so don't trust it for an actual pressure indication. Just for reference, this is in inches of mercury. But regardless, I have a switch here which connects the run winding, and then this button here which connects the start winding. So to start the pump, first you hear this hum. That's the motor that's basically stalled and it can't start. It draws a tremendous amount of current in this state, so you don't want to leave it in this state for too long. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn on the start winding before it even turns on. Now you heard it go through two stages there immediately. But sometimes, you can hear this quieter stage initially, and then once you pump down vacuum, you can kick it into the full speed. If you run the pump at a lower speed, you'll get a lower vacuum and suction rate. More importantly, it's just going to overheat faster because it's not the motor's designed current draw and operating speed. You can see already I've maxed out this gauge, and I've probably damaged this gauge with how much vacuum I'm pulling. Something else that I found that, like all rotary pumps, it does produce a considerable amount of oil mist. So you will want to consider topping up the oil in through the suction side and trying to collect the mist, or at least coalesce the oil droplets so you're not breathing them constantly. I have two filters, one here and one underneath the bench, just to try and reduce the oil vapor coming off. And what I'm probably going to do is I'm just going to pipe the exhaust outside because I don't want to breathe mineral oil or, in this case, ester oil. Also, it would probably be a good idea to switch the oil in this pump. Refrigeration pumps use something known as an ester oil, which, as the name implies, consists of an ester. However, they come with warnings not to expose them to atmospheric moisture and warnings about water contact, so on and so forth. They come new from the factory with rubber plugs and 15 psi of nitrogen in them, so the manufacturers are fairly serious about not getting water in these. That's because when water gets in contact with the oil, it hydrolyzes and it doesn't lubricate properly anymore, which is probably why you heard all that rattling noise. I recently topped this up with mineral oil. What I need to do is actually dump the entire contents and refill it with just mineral oil or a vacuum pump oil. Regardless, you can see that this thing does great as a vacuum pump, and it starts up quick even under vacuum. Right now the gauge is still showing vacuum, yet I can still start it. Unfortunately, you can't really do that with a fridge compressor, not in all cases. Something you will want to note is that when you're running a pump like this, as a vacuum pump, you will overheat it. And in fact, I have this contactless infrared thermometer, and the casing itself is already at 73 degrees Celsius. That's with running the compressor for a little while, trying to do multiple takes of this video, as well as just experimenting with it earlier tonight. This is because in the rotary compressor, you have the actual rotary stage here at the bottom of the cylinder, and then the motor sits on top. In a normal refrigeration loop, you have cold gas coming in from the cold side into the suction port through the rotary stage. At this point, it gets compressed and it warms up a little bit, but it's still relatively cold compared to the motor. And then the gas flows through and around the windings to cool them, and then out the high side of the pump. Now, because you're not having any gas flow under vacuum, you don't get that cooling effect. Now, the casing itself says that the pump can reach 150 degrees Celsius. I've already measured this to hit at least 110 degrees Celsius during operation, and that's only for about half an hour. If you wanted to run it for hours on end, you would definitely want to consider cooling it. What I'm probably going to do is put a fan on this just to make sure it stays relatively cool. Regardless, you also want to look into manufacturer's specifications for duty cycle. I've discovered that this particular air conditioning compressor by LG states that you need a 3-minute rest cycle at least 6 times per hour. I'm probably not going to observe that, and in most cases I don't think manufacturers would actually observe that, considering that 10 minutes of on followed by 3 minutes of off is quite a lot of downtime for an air conditioner. And just in terms of reference, this is probably for a windowsill unit or a smaller refrigeration unit. There are larger whole house air conditioning units which start to get into the scroll compressor range, and anything larger than whole house is absolutely a scroll compressor just because of efficiency. However, scroll compressors cost way too much. One thing that I've noted is that these R22 compressors, because Freon is being phased out and you can't really use it, you can actually get these pretty darn cheap. I don't know whether you can use an R22 compressor with some other refrigerants, but I'm finding that a lot of surplus stores are starting to have these show up on their shelves. I bought this for $15. This whole setup probably cost about $30. So take that for what you will. It's a cheap vacuum pump, and that's just about all the information I have on it. So take the information and build something like this yourself. If you like this video, please rate, subscribe, and comment.